Welcome everybody to our contribution to the first annual SU2 conference. My name is Steffen Schotthöfer and I'm going to talk to you about windowing regularization techniques for unsteady aerodynamic shape optimization. Why do we bother with unsteady periodic flows? Well, many fluid flows in industry are unsteady and turbulent. For example, aerodynamic design of rotorcraft, wind turbine design or flows around bluff bodies in general. For example, an airfoil at high angle of attack. And you can see here below the NACA 0012 airfoil at 17 degrees angle of attack, and the flow is computed with an Urens flow simulation. And yeah, you can see at the first snapshot that is at the start of a period, the Kármán vortex street visible behind the airfoil. Here we see the flow at 1/3 of a period and here at 2/3 of a period. You can observe that the flow field is smooth and has a clear periodicity. And we are going to use this periodicity for our optimization endeavor. What are optimization objectives in periodic flows? Since the flow fields are periodic after some transient time, we have then periodic outputs of the flow, such as the drag or the lift coefficient. We have this transient phase since we usually start from free stream values, which are not physical, and we need some time iterations until the flow field becomes meaningful. And the sensitivities of the drag and lift, for example, they are periodic as well. And the sensitivities are computed with respect to a design vector, which can be any parameterization of the airfoil surface, for example. So the optimization objective is the first idea is to just average over the course of one period. However, the period length t is unknown and it is dependent on the design variable in the case of surface and parameterization as design sensitivities. Now, how do we compute the sensitivity? How do we compute the sensitivity of that? And this is given by this formulation here. The usual approach, and this is what we call the traditional approach, is a finite time averaging. So we just take some finite time m and replace the t, so the period length in our previous definition, by this m, and we hope for convergence of this term to the period average as m goes to infinity. We do similar for the average sensitivity, which is given then by this term, and note that we can now pull the derivative operator inside the integral, since the integral bounds and this term here is no longer dependent on the sensitivity sigma. How does this approach work out for us? We tried this and let's just look at the results. We can see here the drag output of the flow field you've seen earlier. And after about 400 or 500 iterations, the transient phase is over and we have clear periodic behavior of the drag, the time-dependent drag. And in red, you can see the time-dependent drag sensitivity and it changes a bit in amplitude. We start averaging at iteration 500 and average over 700 iterations and stop at 1200. And we got reasonable results for this. However, we wanted to get more accuracy and therefore thought, okay, why not average up to iteration 10,000 since we only get better. However, this is where we got our bad surprise. And you can see here on the right-hand side, the drag sensitivity for some more iterations. And you can see that suddenly the amplitude of the drag sensitivity grows very rapidly in time. And now you can imagine if we take the average over each value in this time frame from 500 to 10,000, we get a huge influence of the average to the average of the last iterations. And this, thus distort our sensitivity values. So we had to admit, yes, the finite time average does converge to the period average value. However, the finite time average sensitivity does not. And This was proven by Krakos et alita, and they introduced a way to mitigate this distortion effect. They introduced a weighted average over some finite time m, and the only difference to the traditional definition is this weighting function w in the time average and the time average sensitivity. W is called a windowing function, and it is a k times differentiable function, which is zero at the at the period bounds or the time frame bounds, and the integral over one period should be one. So the definition of a weighting function. In the context of this definition, we denote a piecewise continuous window by minus one times differentiable. And a piecewise continuous window is, for example, the characteristic function of the open interval 0, 1. And if we plug this definition into this window function here, we just get back our finite time averaging. So this is just a special case of the more general case of, defined by Krakos. Now we ask ourselves, do we get improved convergence properties? And the answer is luckily yes. We get convergence, and it depends on the smoothness of the windowing function w. This is given by the theorem of Krakos et alita, and here first we can look at the windowed time average, and this has convergence order p, and the windowed time average sensitivity has convergence order p minus 1, so one order less of convergence. And p is given by the order of differentiability k. So now let's look back at the finite time average. Here we got k equals to minus 1, so this means p is 1, so order 1 of convergence for the time average, and order 0 for the time average sensitivity. So this gives an idea why our traditional approach does not work. Now the way out is we just define an high order window, so of high order of differentiability, and we plug this in to the optimization framework of SU2. How does this work in detail? To answer this question, we have to look at the mathematical formulation of the optimization problem. We have here the objective function, which is now, for our example here, the window time average drag, which we want to minimize by changing the design. The flow constraint is given by the fixed point formulation of the Urens flow solver. And additionally, we can define an inequality constraint. For example, that the window time average lift should be greater or equal some predefined value c, for example, the windowed lift of the initial design. Now, we discretize the integrals we have defined earlier by the midpoint rule and arrive at this sum formula. And the flow constraint, this is now important for the specific example we give in this paper, in this presentation. However, there are other first order possibilities. We compute it with a second order time marching scheme. So the fixed point iteration of the current time step is dependent of time step n minus 1 and n minus 2. And yeah. Now, how to solve this optimization problem? And usually, and this is what is implemented in SU2, we use some kind of Lagrangian approach. And we need this for efficient computation of the descent direction, so the sensitivity of the objective function j with respect to the design variables. By the Lagrangian approach, we can avoid expensive gradients, for example, the sensitivity of the flow field with respect to the design, and these would appear with using a normal direct differentiation mode. And so the Lagrange function reads as the following. We have the objective function plus the sum of all Lagrange multipliers times the flow constraint. And this gives us, if we minimize the Lagrangian, then we minimize the objective function as well if the flow constraint is fulfilled. This means that this term here is zero. So, and descent direction for the Lagrangian is equal to the descent direction of the objective function. And the Lagrange multipliers are also called adjoint variables. The formal framework for this is the KKT system. So we get partial derivative of the Lagrangian, and the partial derivative with respect to the adjoint give us the state equations. The partial derivative with respect to the flow gives us the adjoint equations. And finally, as I said, the partial derivative with respect to design gives us the design direction equation and finally this descent direction we want. And we are now interested of the form of the latter two, since the state equations, well, they are known and they have no influence of the windowing stuff. Okay, and now let's look at the adjoint sensitivity computation. The adjoint equations are formulated again as an iterator, and we want to look, I want to know how this iterator looks like and if windowing has a huge influence or if we have to change much of this stuff. So we compute a partial derivative and we get this lengthy term here. And this term here, this is the left-hand side of the iterator, so we can forget it for now. And all these terms here stem from the second-order BDF method as a time discretization. And the last term is the influence of the objective function, so the partial derivative of the objective function with respect to the flow. And this is the only term where the windowing function W appears, and it is independent of the adjoint variable. So now we have to check, well, we changed something in this iterator. Is it still a contraction? And then, therefore, a converging iterator. Now, for computation of the contractivity, we just compute the sensitivity of H with respect to the current adjoint variable. However, the current adjoint variable only occurs in this term here, so we get the sensitivity, and this is just this here. And this is the necessary condition for contractivity of our primal run. However, we already computed our primal run in this case at this point, so we know it converges. And therefore, the adjoint iterator inherits convergence of the direct iterator. And since this part here is completely independent of the window, since the windowing part is independent of the adjoint, we get inheritance regardless of the window function we have chosen or implemented. So this is a good point. And now we look at the design equation, and we get here again the influence of the objective function, where we get we have here our windowing function, and this is the converged adjoint variable of the adjoint iterator. And here again, we have the windowing function that only appears as a so-called seeding factor. So as a consequence for implementation and computation, this is super cheap, since we have one or at least in the order of one floating point operations on top of our traditional approach. So compared to the rest of the computation, this is really nothing. And it is easy to implement. We just have to add a seeding function to the adjoint when we construct the adjoint iterator in SU2. So these are good properties. But how does this whole windowing stuff perform in the field, so to say? So we are looking again at our NACA airfoil test case, and we use the Urens flow solver with a JST flux and Spallert-Almarez turbulence model and the following Reynolds and Mach numbers to get an unsteady flow. And yeah, we compare two different approaches. The traditional one, this is given by the so-called square window, which is just our characteristic function here marked in blue. And for a reminder, we expect order one of convergence for the average and no convergence for the sensitivity. Compared to that, we use a high order window, the Hund square window, which is three times differentiable. Therefore, we expect order 5 and respectively order 4 of convergence. And one thing you can already see here is that a high order window will always wait the ends of the time frame, so the boundaries of the time frame here and here, way less than the middle of the time frame. And yeah, so we have less influence of this high values of the oscillating sensitivity you saw on the second slide. So before we look at optimization results, we look at surface sensitivities for our discrete adjoint sensitivity computation, since they give more details what happens really with the square window. And in this picture, you see here in the background in black the suction side and the pressure side of our Naka airfoil, and on both sides I have plotted the sensitivity values. And we have two sensitivity values for each point, and these are one, the sensitivity value with a final iteration n1, and one with another final iteration, and the difference is 1/3 of a period. And I've used a time frame that is long enough to, well, expect convergence. However, we know we don't get convergence of the square window, and this manifests in here in this case in three critical zones. The first one here, where we really have a great difference of the surface sensitivities for different final iterations, and second here in this critical zone, and third near the trailing edge here. This means that square windowing really is very sensitive with respect to the choice of the final iteration. Yeah, and this is not good for optimization, since we don't know when we have a matching final iteration, so to say. However, in the case of our high order window, Hund square, we have a different picture. We look again at, so everything is the same in this computation, except we use the Hund square or a window instead of the traditional one. So again, two computations that differ at 1/3 of the period. And we look again at the critical zones, and we can see that here we have almost no difference of the surface sensitivities, and the same at a trailing edge. And here in this critical zone, we have at least a much reduced distance of the sensitivities. This means that Hund square windowing is quite robust with respect to the choice of the final iteration, and this is a good property for shape optimization. Indeed, now let's look at some results of the shape optimization runs. First, in the case of square windowing, we have here the initial design, so the baseline Naka airfoil, and here the design that is optimized after 15 iterations. And you can notice several things. First, we have, if you look closely, we have a point of flow separation that is a bit further back on the airfoil compared to the initial design. And this can be seen here in the plot of the skin friction coefficient of the suction side. And you can see here that we have flow separation at about 23% or 20% airfoil length. So the flow detaches itself further back on the wing, and this means we get somehow a bit optimization. Compared to this, the Hund square windowing looks a bit different. And the first thing we observe is that we don't have any more this Kármán vortex street, but instead we get a steady state flow for optimization, optimized design. And second, consulting the skin friction coefficient plot, we see that our flow separation occurs again further back on the airfoil, and this is at 30% airfoil length, which means an about 50% increase compared to the square window design. So with this in mind, we expect a lower drag for the Hund square optimized window for the Hund square optimized design. To confirm that, let's look at the design process over each design iteration. On the left-hand side, we have the square windowing, and you can see in blue the drag over each design iteration, and in red the lift, windowed lift of and the window track, of course, of each design iterations. And the black line here in the background is the lift constraint, and we have chosen it as the windowed lift lift coefficient of the baseline design. So we don't want to get a worse lift than we have initially. And you can see here the following. On the bright side, we have indeed a 60% drag reduction in the end. This is not bad, but you see this oscillating behavior, and this means that every second design proposal, and this is meant in the sense of a proposal to the line search of the optimization algorithm, is infeasible. So each second time we decrease our drag coefficient, we also decrease our lift coefficient in a way that we don't get a feasible design, and this is a huge waste of computational time. Compared to this, we have the Hahn-Square-Windot optimization process here. And again, blue is the drag, red is the lift, and black is the lift constraint. And as you can see, the windowed lift constraint stays very close to the lift constraint. And after only 5 design iterations, we get a feasible lift and a very low drag. So we could, at this point, we could stop our optimization run and get results that are as good as the square windowed optimization process with using only 1/3 of the iterations. However, if we let run it to the end, we get 81% drag reduction, which is 20% more than in the case of drag. And we get similar results for other higher order windows. So the bottom line of this here is that we have really an huge increase in design in optimization quality and a huge decrease in computational time that we need. So yeah, there's that. Finally, I want to talk a bit about the implementation and the usage of this windowing functionality in SU2. And there are 2 possibilities, basically, to use windowing in SU2. The first one that you have seen already is the adjoint sensitivity computation with respect to via the Lagrange approach and automatic differentiation. And the second one is to use this in the direct iteration, so in a direct flow simulation or a direct differentiation, so the tangent mode of AD or forward mode. And yeah. Basically, a few words to the windowing class in SU2. This is all managed by the class C windowing tools and its child classes. So it is really easy to maintain and to add new windowing functions, and then you don't have to touch other stuff of the code. And the windowing tools are implemented for the adjoint iterators for single zone and multi zone drivers. Okay, how to use this adjoint mode? First, of course, you have to define what windowing function you need. And in this example, we use the Hanning window. This is another high order window. Then, since the adjoint mode of the adjoint mode in SU2 contains first of a direct run and then of the adjoint iterator, we first have to define the time iteration we want to stop our direct run. And in our example, this is the iteration 1200. Yeah. And of course, we want to specify when to start the time average, and this is in our case iteration 500. Okay, then the direct iteration of SU2 runs forward, and after that we need to start our adjoint run. So we need to tell our adjoint iterator when to start, and this is usually in all unsteady adjoint stuff in SU2 done via the option unsteady adjoint iteration, which is then put to 1200. And after that, we have to specify over how many iterations the adjoint iterator has to needs to run. And this is given by the option eta average objective, which is then, 1000 minus 500, it's 700 iterations. So the adjoint iterator stops to seed the windowing function at iteration 500 in this case. And finally, of course, we have to choose our optimization objective, which is, yeah, in our case, given by the drag. And yeah, this is everything basically that it's this windowing function here and the window start iteration is the new stuff that is different from a usual shape optimization run. Okay, now let's look at the direct mode. And in the direct mode, windowing is a kind of post-processing step. This means we first compute our with the direct iterator the flow solution at some given time point n, and then we compute the so-called, so to say, running windowed average. So we compute the windowed average over the a time span n minus ntr, which is the window start iteration in our case. And of course, we have to define again the windowing function. Now we take Hund square windowing. And just like the direct run of the discrete adjoint mode, we need to define our window start iteration. However, since this is just a post-processing step, we can apply this windowed average to all output fields, so all output coefficient of the screen output and the history output. And all you have to do for this is to use the prefix t, so time average underscore, for a simple window time average, and d underscore time average underscore for time average sensitivity. An example for a screen output is if you want a time average drag, you have to specify t a vg drag, and here d time average drag for a time average sensitivity of the drag. Similar for the history output, the only difference is here that you need to specify the output groups, not the fields. Okay, and then the value of the value that is written in the history output is then the windowed average from the starting iteration up to the current iteration. And this can be used again then for convergence monitoring, time convergence monitoring for periodic outputs. And what I mean by this is the following. The idea is that the running windowed average should be a Cauchy sequence since it is a is expected to converge in some sense. And you can see it here on the in this example. We have in the dotted line, this is the drag, the time-dependent drag, and here we have in blue the running windowed average using a square window, and in red the running windowed average using the Hund square window. And besides these first iterations, since the finite time average does not give meaningful values when using it for a time frame that is shorter than one time period, we see that the running window time average of the Hund square, so the high order window, converges quite stops to oscillate quite fast and then converges to this level here. And compared to this, we have oscillation in the running average of the using the square window, and this can be traced back to the lower order of convergence. So, however, then we can use compute the Cauchy residual, so to say, of the last few iterations. And how to activate this? We use the option window Cauchy criterion, and we specify then the convergence, the field that we want to monitor. And for example, this can be a time average or a time average sensitivity. Then we specify how many elements of the of this Cauchy sequence we want to use, and after that we want to we have to define an epsilon. And if this Cauchy, the sum of all these elements is lower than this epsilon, then we stop our time iteration. Okay, how can this be used for an efficient shape optimization workflow? Example is the following: we do some pre-processing before starting the actual optimization. And first we start with a simulation, and to get the end of the transient phase, this has to be done anyways. And then we start, we save the restart files, so we can avoid computing the transient phase in each design iteration later in the shape optimization. After that, we do some second pre-processing step. And we use a direct differentiation mode of SU2 and use the window time convergence monitoring I showed you earlier to get the minimal number of time iterations that it's needed for a converged window sensitivity. And this number of time iterations can be then used for our end time for the shape optimization process. And there we use the restart files and this minimal time frame. So here we can use save some computational time. So this is an a proposal for some utility that you can use. Okay, so let's end this talk with a quick summary and conclusion. First, we have seen that the traditional time averages fail to compute sensitivities correctly in periodic flows. In contrast to this, long-time windowing yields faster convergence of periodic averages and correct sensitivities. We have seen that windowing is easy to embed in adjoint sensitivity solvers, and it gives a robust surface sensitivity with respect to changing final times. Finally, window shape optimization processes converge faster and are able to fulfill design constraints. A traditional time approach fails to do this. Okay, now a remark regarding future work. Right now, this windowing stuff is, at least in theory, or in our experience, applied to urine flows. And as a personal new project, I want to apply it to scale resolving methods, and there we have not the single frequency that we have to monitor, but multiple frequencies. And the idea is that then we can decompose the flow field at the flow output and apply windowing to each base frequency. Okay, that's it. Thank you for your attention, and hope to see you soon in real life.